culture. Culture means everything in the NBA, and it can take many forms. At the heart of every beloved team in history is a coach with a personality or energy so distinct that their entire team mirrors that image. On today's episode of Courtside, we'll be analyzing two of the NBA's greatest godfathers of culture, Pat Riley and Phil Jackson, comparing their coaching styles, philosophies, similarities, and differences. This is not a who was greater, but instead, a look at just how different culture can come alive in the NBA. In 1972, the Los Angeles Lakers won their sixth championship. At the time, Pat Riley was a reserve player coming off the bench. 8 years later, he found himself as the assistant coach of yet another championship Lakers team. Pat Riley, championship Lakers. The two nearly became synonymous. In just two seasons, Pat Riley would rise to head coach and lead the Lakers to four more titles. Riley didn't just show what it took to win in LA. He showed the world what it looked like for LA to win over the world. Riley did. With Magic Johnson running his fast breaks, dishing out never-before-seen passes, and Kareem down low, the NBA was revamped. The entire team became a persona of its own that defined 80s basketball. And at the helm of the ship, in his Armani suits and slick back hair, was Pat Riley. Never had we seen a man with such determination and blue-collar work ethic make winning look so Hollywood. Once he shifted gears to coach the New York Knicks of the 90s, Riley was able to leave behind the glamour and gold shell he had created for himself in LA. The raw and gritty nature of Riley's no-excuse basketball fueled Madison Square Garden during an era of its greatest games. It was in New York that Riley finally embodied a by-any-means-necessary approach to the game, with Ewing, Oakley, and Starks as his bulldogs. Final stage to date in Riley's dynasty is in South Beach. Accomplishing what he couldn't with the Knicks, Pat brought Miami his first championship. He would continue his winnings in management as the mastermind architect behind the Miami Big Three that won an additional two championships. That makes five consecutive decades of reaching the pinnacle of winning in the NBA. No doubt, solidifying Pat Riley as one of a kind. Speaking of, Phil Jackson, also a former NBA player, played almost the exact same reserve role when he won his first ring with the New York Knicks in 1973. That's right, Riley won in 72, and Phil won the very next season in 73. Phil, however, would have a tougher journey to coaching in the NBA. Having a reputation as a nonconformist, nonetheless, he made that leap in 1987 as assistant coach of the Chicago Bulls. 2 years later, he had become a strong advocate of Tex Winter's triangle offense and was soon promoted to head coach. I think we all know the story from here. But for those who don't, Phil Jackson would go on to coach the Michael Jordan, Scottie Pippen-led Chicago Bulls to three straight championships. In one of the most bizarre moves in history at the time, Coach Phil Jackson reached out to none other than Dennis Rodman, a hated rival of his two superstars, with an invitation to play for Chicago, to which Rodman said,
"So basically said, Dennis, you want to come play for the Bulls?" I said, "I don't care. Whatever. What's up?"
This move amounted to another three straight championships for Jackson and the Bulls. Phil took a one-year absence from the game and returned to Los Angeles in the company of Shaquille O'Neal and a young Kobe Bryant. As was tradition by the time, Jackson managed to win another three straight championships with this Lakers duo. Jackson took another break from basketball for several years. But sure enough, he returned to bring two more championships to LA. this time reconciling with a matured Kobe Bryant. For those keeping score at home, that's Pat Riley 9, Phil Jackson 13. I think many would agree in saying that one word at the root of all this winning is philosophy. If philosophy was a human being, his name would be Phil Jackson. Known as the Zen Master, Jackson instilled spiritual practices, habits, and mindsets in every one of his teams and players. Every act Phil made was methodical, with a blend of psychology, mysticism, and a deep understanding of the human experience. Jackson went so far as to write his own list of principles for mindful leadership, known as the Jackson 11. Pat Riley, on the other hand, recalls teaching a philosophy he didn't even know he had when he first began with the Lakers. The two shared a common belief in their philosophies of team unity. Both emphasized empowering each player in their role and the significance of contribution at each level from star to reserve. How they went about this is what so drastically differed. Phil Jackson would study his players to learn the best ways to motivate them individually. If that meant taking Kobe aside and telling him he needed to take a step back for Shaq's ego, that's what he did. No. That's actually what he did. Phil was known for his phrase, bench the ego. To him, this meant it wasn't about the coach, but instead about the players. Jackson delegated power to his players and allowed them to lead one another, with him more as a supervisor than a focal point. To him, there was no need to constantly assert himself in the locker room as head authority. This is about as opposite from Riley's approach as you can get. For Pat Riley, there was no star treatment. You were either all in or all out with Pat. His motivation was intoxicating, with countless testimonies from players and staff alike attributing their own success in the toughest of moments to Riley's uplifting speeches and methods. Riley sees life as a blend of successes and failures, determined by your attitude and actions. He believes that the success of winning a championship is fleeting, so the goal must be larger than this at all times. Jackson's views were similar in this life larger than basketball sentiment. Meditation and mindfulness were his trademark techniques for enhancing players' reserve during critical moments in big games. Kobe, Shaq, and Michael Jordan all reference Phil Jackson as their sole influence in visualization techniques that had them feeling the sensations of winning MVPs and holding the Larry O'Brien trophy before these visions came in line with reality. The triangle offense. Phil Jackson used this offensive tactic for all of his championship teams from 1991 to 2010, and multiple options for scoring always become available. Regardless of the personnel, the system seemed to always work and result in victory, much to Phil's delight. Preparation and execution are key words of Jackson's defensive scheme. His team's losses were always largely attributed to lack of defensive execution. Shaq's defense, outside of his youth, was notably better only when playing for Phil Jackson. Riley's Lakers relentlessly picked off passes in the passing lanes to kick off their fast breaks. An outlet pass would then be thrown down court, and any extra pass needed would be made for the dunk or fancy lay-in. When they weren't in transition, Kareem's low post was instant offense. Riley's Knicks were also quite athletic, but worked more off of elbow cuts and their bigs playing behind the defense, slipping by the unsuspecting defender for an easy dunk. Their offensive teamwork and ball movement capitalized on their strong slashing abilities to score at the rim. Riley's defense can be summed up in one sentence.
He told the Knicks, nobody goes down the lane.
No layup rule. If you can't block it, put him down.
This began in his Laker days and continued throughout each team he coached, some more than others. The best protect, get that. The best protect, get that. The best protect, get that. Fortuna. As for the big games, the two coaches' energy couldn't be any more different. Pat's teams were often at boiling point when things got tense, and he himself was often the one to boil over. Meanwhile, Phil, by design of his meditative practices, projected confidence and poise, even at times when most teams would be falling apart at the seams. With this demeanor, his team was better able to make rational, smart decisions rather than reactive ones, and the opposing team would often break their own concentration, wondering how Jackson's players were so calm. Perhaps having control over your own mind is the greatest mind game of all. At the end of the day, Phil Jackson may far surpass Pat Riley in career accolades and overall coaching status, but when it comes to building culture from the ground up, Riley may just have the upper hand. Regardless, these two coaches are unlike any others and deserve their spots on the Mount Rushmore of coaching.